Yes, let's resume our meeting. Agenda item number 5, implementation of 5-day week in the government. We have got 3 papers. First, I will give the floor to Mr. Joshua Law, Secretary for the Civil Service, to introduce the paper to us. Mr. Law, thank you. In our paper, we have set out that as the situation as end of 2018, and also the situation since October 2018 to date, I will briefly introduce the details to you. The government attaches significance to the quality of life of civil servants, and we want to provide a family-friendly work environment for our colleagues. One of the measures is to implement 5-day week. Yet the government has the duty to ensure that the 5-day week initiative will not affect the level and efficiency of public service or incurring additional costs to taxpayers. So to achieve the policy objective, we have to adhere to 4 basic principles. First, no additional staffing resources. Second, no reduction in the conditioned hours of service of individual staff. C, no reduction in emergency services. And D, continued provision of essential counter services on Saturdays and Sundays. We conduct a survey once every 2 years to gauge the implementation of the policy. As at end or the 30th of December 2018, about 133,500 civil servants are working 5-day week, accounting for 75% of the total civil service strength, up 2% compared with what it was 2 years ago. At the 30th of September 2018, the civil service strength has increased by 6,800, and yet more than 8,000 more civil servants worked on 5-day week. Departments continue to carry out pilot schemes to see whether more colleagues can migrate to FDW. According to a latest survey, about 7,000 civil servants serving the CSD, food, F and FEHD and Hong Kong PF and LCSD started a trial scheme. And then some departments have got new trial schemes, including the Hong Kong Police Force, the Hong Kong Postal Office, and also the District Office. We will listen to the views of the colleagues, and we will discuss with the management of departments to explore the feasibility of FDW. Since 2013, the CSD has invited departments to explore the feasibility of revising the existing leave deduction arrangements for their non-FDW civil servants. As at the 31st of March 2019, Hong Kong Police Force, the Customs and Excise Department, and CSD were conducting their respective pilot schemes on revised LDW, covering a total of more than 13,000 non-FDW civil servants. CSB has also shared information about the revised SDA pilot schemes of the above-mentioned departments with other departments with non-FDW civil servants to facilitate their consideration of similar proposals. Thank you. Each member will have 5 minutes to ask questions, and our question answers will also be included. I will apply the rule flexibly, because we have enough time. Mr. Pun Xiuping, Paragraph 2 sets out the policy objectives of the FDW. Now, there must be no additional staff resources, no reduction in the conditioned hours of service, and no reduction in emergency services, and continuation of essential counter services at weekends. And the purpose is to raise the quality of civil servants' family life. More than 40,000 civil servants are still not able to enjoy FDEW. So it is very unfair to some civil servants, and this is also a blow to their morale. Some staff associations have expressed their discontent to me. They have said to their management time and again that they want FDW. They have also submitted proposals to their management side, hoping to have a balanced implementation of FDW. Unfortunately, most of the time, their management's response would be infeasible, impossible. I'm sure some colleagues have also received submissions from these staff associations, including one from the Government Amenity Management Supervisors General Union. They feel that they're being treated as slaves. At the last special FC meeting, I wanted to ask this question regarding the four basic principles. Theoretically speaking, every 3 years, you have special financial provision in your budget. If you can adjust the resources, you will be able to fully implement FDW. Although you said in your paper that you're pleased to see progress every year, in fact, the average growth is only 2% when it comes to the number of civil servants that can enjoy FDW. And we don't know how long they have to wait until everyone can enjoy FDW. All right, there is such a demand from the staff union. Will CSB mediate between these departments and the staff side? At least there should be a pilot trial of 3 months, because they feel that senior management are already enjoying FDW for the frontline staff they have served for more than 20 years, and still they cannot enjoy it. And this is not conducive to morale.
Yeah. Now, secondly, now you tell us that in some departments, such as the CSD or LCSD, they are now have their own pilot schemes. Now, once the scheme is over, can they migrate to 5 day week? Now, so the 1300 task force members, will they enjoy the 5 day week? Now, so will you ask these departments to migrate to FDW as soon as possible? Now, on the department's initiatives, I believe the departments should listen more to views and communicate with staff. Now, when I see the bureau's heads and when I go on visits, I try to understand the situation and encourage them to explore different ways to move forward towards 5 day week. Now, we will continue in that effort. Now, as for pilot schemes, now, the pilot schemes of individual departments, if they are successful, now the number of pilot schemes is small. Now, if they are successful, if the shift arrangements and the working arrangements can be maintained, then the pilot scheme should be extended to other job categories. Any other questions from members on the five-day week? Ms. Chen Huayan? I'd like to ask about the latest development. Now, near territories north and Kowloon East, the emergency unit, there are 900 police officers involved. Now, these are three regions involved. Now, if the entire police force is going to work on a five-day week basis, you should have enough staff for the shifts. Is there a problem with the manpower so that you cannot change? Now I understand that some officers will have to work longer hours on weekdays, so they finish their work day at a rather odd hour. For instance, 6:34 or so. It's rather cumbersome or odd. Now, we try to be exact. The original 6 days or 5.5 days, the hours would be then divided by five. Now, I believe most staff members don't exactly look at the minute hand of the watch that closely. They finish their work before they leave, but we try to give the message that we even out the work over 5 days instead of 6 or 5.5. Now, as for the pilot scheme at the police force, whether it can be extended to other regions, I believe the head of the bureau or the force will consider the actual situation. Now, as for whether there are requirements in assigning shifts, I understand that some departments are introducing a computer system to make the shift arrangement. So as to facilitate the assignment of shifts. Now, if they need to redeploy staff for the shift arrangements, they do enjoy the flexibility. Are there any more questions from members on the FDW? Pun Siu-ping, second round. Now, the document mentions the way forward at the CSB. Now, it says the CSB at this stage will abide by the four basic principles. Now, it's expected that those who do not enjoy FDW, unless new shift arrangements can be made, they will not enjoy FDW. Now, we understand that the administration will have to adjust the resources involved. Now, you are saying that those who are not fully on FDW can try to work out new options, and you suggest that the departments talk to the staff associations. Now, looking from the staff association, the one on the document from the amenity management group, it seems that the departments always reply negatively that the proposals are not feasible. Now, if the CSB play a middleman's role to give a fair opinion on whether the FDW is feasible for those departments, because otherwise, if the impasse drags on, it will affect the morale and service, quality of service. Now, it must be the head of department who is most familiar with the actual situation of the department concerned. Of course, we encourage them to communicate more with the staff. In the case of the LCSD Staff Association, now I will ask my colleague to elaborate on this, because he has been having a close contact with this Government Amenity Management Supervisors General Union, and there have been successful migration to FDW in some units. The Assistant Secretary. Now, in the case of the LCSD Staff Association, if we receive certain information, then we will directly try to understand the true picture from the department. Now, in our understanding, the department and the staff, the management and the staff do communicate on the FDW. If the staff have actual proposals, the management will deal with that. Now, for some stadiums and playgrounds, now the opening hours are all different, so it has to be on a case-by-case basis. Now, recently, we received information that FDW is not feasible at a certain location, at a certain stadium. And we went and looked into that, and we understand that two supervisors have to be on site. Now, there are only two supervisors. One morning, one evening. Now, if there is to be a 5-day week, the overlap would have to be 3 hours instead of 1.5 hours. And if there's a 5-day week, then the day the officer is off, there would be no one doing the job. So in this case, there is actual difficulty for FDW. Is that correct? Now for the discipline services, how is the FDW progressing? Now, for some discipline services, for instance, the fire services department, the FDW has been quite successful. And now, which departments face greater difficulty, and how does the administration propose to improve that? The secretary. Now, among the discipline services, the situations are all different. For instance, the aviation unit, they are almost 100% FDW, fire services, it's 97%. As for immigration department, it's 64% on FDW for the police force. 54% approximately, CNE 43%, CSD, it's a rather unique situation, it's only 22%. Now, I believe all the disciplined services are working hard on trying to implement the scheme where feasible. For instance, in CSD, at different institutions, they have different FDW schemes, and perhaps at one institution, there are two different shift arrangements, some 5 days, some 5.5 days or 6 days. So they do try to be imaginative. Now, in some cases, it's 100%. In some cases, only 22%. And 60-odd percent is not satisfactory either. And it seems that you are leaving the departments to find ways themselves. Now, has the administration tried to understand whether these problems can be resolved within the department, or whether more resources have to be provided? Because the FDW is a government promise to the entire civil service. Every member of the civil service should be able to enjoy that, so that there can be a better balance between home life and work, and it will affect morale. If everyone can enjoy FDW, it will be much better. Now, have you tried to gain a better standing on how to resolve the difficulties for the disciplined services? Whether it's disciplined services or the clerical or office types of jobs, we try to understand the situation. Now, in some departments, mainly the discipline services, they provide 24-hour service. For instance, the CSD, they require 24-hour service. And for other discipline services, like at the boundary crossing points on Saturdays and Sundays, people have to be on duty throughout the day. So the department head will have to try to come up with arrangements for FDW. For instance, FDW is on a 24-hour service, but they are almost 100% on FDW. So I believe the heads of the discipline service concerned would be the most qualified to find ways to implement FDW. Now, different pilot schemes are in progress, and when the schemes are completed, I believe the number of FDW cases can increase. Now, for those who are not yet on FDW, will you provide special allowances to compensate them because they do not have the leave that others enjoy?
I believe Dr. Quart will understand that for disciplined services that are not yet able to implement FDW, they are exploring revised leave deduction arrangements for non-5-day week arrangements. to put on par with their counterparts who are enjoying FDW. So they are doing it, and there is improvements year on year. If there are no further questions, then we end the discussion of item 4. Item 5, AOB. Mrs. Regina Yip. Well, I have a question for the CSB. There are many remedies, there are many disciplined services quarters to facilitate their attending work. Now, for those who work in district offices in the NT, some officials' headquarters in the NT, but there aren't any more. And then for those who work in the urban areas and had to attend work in the NT, they had a mileage allowance, but it is no longer available. And you know, some colleagues have to drive a long way. If they work in the if they work in the NT and yet live in the urban areas, sometimes they drive from the Eastern District to work in Tuen Mun. They have to drive a long time, but there is no allowance for them. You know, they need a subsidy for fuel and for repair or maintenance of their vehicles. I'd like to know the reasons for removing such allowances. I do have such information with me, but I understand that individual discipline services may have a work-related traffic allowance. If Mrs. Yip so wishes, I can share with her such information. No, I'm just talk about disciplined services. There are civilian grades and also colleagues working in district offices and even district land offices. Some may live in the Eastern District and have to drive all the way to the North District. It's not realistic to expect them to move to the North Thin districts just for a three-year posting. Can there be some traffic allowance? When I first joined the civil service, I was aware of some of the allowances you referred to, but back then the public transport network and coverage of the railway system was very different from what it is now. Now it is more convenient, and the government encourages colleagues to use public transport as far as possible. Mileage allowance was subject to a review many years ago, and it's been abolished. Now for civil service colleagues attending work, we do not pay, we do not take into account where they live. And Mrs. Yip referred to quarters for the disciplined services. And they have to, they cannot choose where they are allocated quarters. And for other cases, usually they have to choose a place which is well served by public transport network, so that they will not be so burdensome for them to attend work. I really know that there are civilian officers that have to travel a long way to get to work. I don't know the exact number of such cases, but the SALG should be a good employer. It should consider giving some arrangements for these civilian officers. Please bear this in mind. Yes, we will consider this. Secretary, you said that some of the information could not be available now. We welcome you to give us a supplementary paper after the meeting for Mrs. Regina Ip's information. If there are no other AOB items, I'd like to say that we are more than 20 minutes ahead of schedule. And if we take into account that 5-minute break, then we have still more than 30 minutes left. And this confirms what Mr. Jeremy TAM said. We do have the possibility to deal with three relevant and controversial issues in one meeting. So please consider doing so in the future. We rely on you. In deciding whether two or three issues should be scheduled into one meeting. Thank you. The meeting ends here. Thank you very much for your attendance.